Maxwell equations are a set of fundamental relationships that explain how electric and magnetic fields are generated and interacted with each other. Electromagnetic radiation and much of today's electrical and telecommunication technologies is based on four magic equations, which are coded as being the most important equations of all time. Let's look at them one by one. Gauss's law for the electric field. Gauss's law for the electric field states that electric charges give rise to electric field in a direction based on the sign of that electric charge. Specifically, the electric flux emanating from a closed surface is equal to the charge enclosed by that surface. Consider a closed surface with some charge distribution within it. From Gaussian electric field law, this electric charge generates electric field, and the flux of that field is proportional to the total charge contained within that surface. Flux of a vector field is the amount of field passing through the closed surface. Gauss's law for the magnetic field. Gauss's law for the magnetic field states that the magnetic flux emanating from a closed surface is equal to zero. Magnetic flux enters a certain part of a closed surface, must leave through the remainder of the closed surface. That arises directly from the fact that in nature, there is no isolated magnetic monopoles. Every magnetic north pole is accompanied by its corresponding south pole, and these two poles can never be separated. If you get a magnet and are still breaking it into smaller and smaller pieces, you're always gonna get two poles, south and north. The magnetic flux generated by the north pole of the magnet is always get pulled by the south pole, so the net flux passing through the closed surface is always zero. These two equations give us complete understanding of the behavior of a static electric charge and magnetic dipole. But what happens when electric charge and magnetic dipole start to move? Here come the third and the fourth equations. The third equation represents the outcome of Faraday's experiment in 1831, and it simply tells us that a changing magnetic field produces circularly moving electric field. The electric field produced here in Faraday's law is quite different from the electrostatic one produced by electric charge in Gauss' law. Charge-based electric field begins in positive charge and terminates in negative one, while induced electric field loops back on itself with no point of originating or terminating. That's why it has no divergence, or its total flux passing through the closed surface is zero. The fourth and final equation is Ampere's law with Maxwell's modification. Both electric current and time-varying electric field through a surface produce the same effect, a circulating magnetic field around any path bounding that surface. The term that involves the derivative of electric field is called displacement current, a term that Maxwell pulled out of thin air to produce the wave equation. Ampere's law contains only the first part of the right-hand side. Electric current going through a wire induces a circulating magnetic field, and that converges with Bayes-Savart law. Magnetic field is generated only by moving charges. But Maxwell found out that this is valid only for the case of static situations, like direct current. In direct current, there is no acceleration or change in direction in the charge movement. To extend Ampere's law to time-dependent situations, Maxwell added what's called displacement current, or capacitive current. This quantity is in fact a term of electric current. Let me explain how he added the second term. Continuity equation. Suppose we have a closed surface with some charge distributed within it. Continuity equation states that the divergence of current density or the amount of electric current flowing out of the surface is equal to the negative rate of a change of the charge density. Recall that electric current is the flow of electric charge. So if the divergence of current density is positive, then more charge is exiting than entering the volume. Hence, the amount of charge within the volume must be decreasing. That's why we have a negative sign here. And if the electric current is flowing into the surface with negative divergence, then the amount of electric charge must be increasing. If we take the divergence of both sides of Ampere's law, the left-hand side would be zero, because the divergence of any circulating vector field is always zero. The amount of field entering any closed surface is equal to the amount of field exiting, so the divergence of curl is zero. So we get the divergence of current density is zero. That result is inconsistent with the continuity equation, so Ampere's law doesn't satisfy the continuity equation. We can substitute electric charge enclosed by the surface from Gauss' law by the divergence of electric field. That important relationship tells us if we have a closed surface and by some way we can generate time-varying electric field passing through it, this surface will feel like there is electric current passing through it with magnitude equal to the rate of a change of that electric field. So the general form of electric current can be modified to be the conduction current that depends on the conductivity of the medium, as well as another component that feels like electric current. But unlike the conduction current, it doesn't depend on the conductivity of the medium. It doesn't even need any medium to exist, and as expected it has the same effect as electric current, a rotating magnetic field. So Ampere's law can be modified to include its displacement current, the component that makes it satisfy the continuity equation. And that tells us even if the system is not conductive, we can still get magnetic field from the displacement current component. So if we can by some way generate time-varying magnetic field even without moving electric charge, from Faraday's law for example, we expect to have a rotating time-varying magnetic field associated with it from the modified Ampere's law, which will generate time-varying electric field again from Faraday's law, and so on and so forth. From the third and fourth equations, electric and magnetic fields are coupled together. The space derivative of electric field gives rise to magnetic field, and the space derivative of magnetic field gives us electric field. To see how the wave propagates in free space, we must solve them simultaneously. To make life easy, let's decouple them into two independent equations that relate electric and magnetic fields independently. But before doing that, let's talk about something very important to us as electrical engineers. In electrical engineering, we prefer to find the behavior of the system for sinusoidal signal. That's simply because any signal can be decomposed into sum of weighted harmonically related sinusoids, according to Fourier approximation. So if we suppose that electric and magnetic fields are sinusoidal functions of time, then the derivative of it is simply multiplying it by j omega. And the four Maxwell equations can be rewritten in a time harmonic form. Changing magnetic and electric fields are interrelated. Space derivative of one corresponds to time derivative of the other. By simple math manipulation, we can decouple these two equations to get two other independent ones that describe how electric and magnetic fields vary independently. These two decoupled equations are called wave equations. The solution for electric and magnetic field wave equations is consisting of forward traveling wave and backward traveling wave. And for an electric field oriented in the x direction and varies with respect to time and z direction, the corresponding magnetic field according to Maxwell equations is aligned in the y direction and also varies with respect to time and z direction. Let's take a deeper look at the forward traveling part of the solution. The electric and magnetic fields are varying sinusoidally with respect to the z direction. Since we assume the variation with respect to time to be sinusoidal, the electric and magnetic fields are varying sinusoidally with respect to time and space. By freezing space variation and varying the time, we notice that the function moves as the time goes on. This is the concept of wave propagation. As time progresses, the wave propagates in the z direction. Electric and magnetic fields in an electromagnetic wave are perpendicular to each other and are also perpendicular to the direction of the wave propagation. Even circuit theory and transmission line theory are based on Maxwell equations. Kirchhoff voltage law and Kirchhoff current law that form the basis for circuit theory are just the approximate version of Maxwell equations. Now you know that the wave behavior arises fundamentally due to the coupling terms in Faraday's and Ampere's modified laws. A change in electric field causes a change in magnetic field, which causes a change in electric field, and so on. If we were to set either mu naught or epsilon naught to zero, the coupling terms would disappear, and no wave equation would result. In Faraday's law, if mu naught is set to zero, then the line integral of electric field or the voltage around any closed path is zero. This is exactly the Kirchhoff voltage law. And when epsilon naught is equal to zero in Ampere Maxwell equation, the curl of the magnetic field depends only on the conduction current density J. Taking the divergence of both sides while keeping in mind that the divergence of curl is always equal to zero, we get the Kirchhoff current law. The divergence of current density at any node is always equal to zero, meaning that the current entering a node must be equal to the current flowing out of it. Permittivity and permeability are two non-zero quantities, but approximating them with zero gives us a great advantage. We know that the speed of wave propagation is 1 over square root of mu naught epsilon naught. Setting one of them or both to zero means the speed is infinity. So Kirchhoff voltage law and Kirchhoff current law are valid approximation of Maxwell equations as long as the circuit element's dimensions are too small compared to the wavelengths of the signal, so we don't feel the finiteness of the speed of the wave.